I hope you've had a wonderful day, and I am excited to be able to introduce to you our David Axelrod. He is a University of Chicago alumnus. We are and a 35-year veteran of American politics and journalism. Prior to becoming a political consultant, David spent 8 years as a reporter and columnist for the Chicago Tribune, including a stint as the City Hall Bureau Chief. And as a political consultant, David has managed media and communication strategy for more than 150 local, state, and national campaigns, most notably serving as senior strategist to President Obama. He is a wonderful citizen of the University of Chicago and a wonderful partner for me. He's been so kind to speak at our events, and so I bring you David Axelrod.
Now can you hear me? Great. I was in fact a student here at the University of Chicago back in the Pleistocene era, about 100 million years ago. It's a great, great university. But one of the things that drew me to Chicago was that Chicago, then as now, was a great political town. And even as a young person, I was interested in politics. One of the things that I missed here was that for all the wonderful education that we got, there was no way to engage with practitioners in politics, with contemporary politics. And so I began to think, as I was winding down my career in campaigns, that it would be great to bring an Institute of Politics back here to the University of Chicago to give students a chance to interact with practitioners, to talk not just about issues in politics, but also to learn a little bit about different aspects of engagement in the political arena, in public policy. We opened up in January of 2013. Since that time, we've had well over 250 speakers here, ranging from Vice President Biden and Governor Jeb Bush I should have a list in front of me, to an array of really interesting people across the political spectrum. It's been an extraordinary experience for me, primarily because of the young people who I've interacted with, because ultimately our mission is to inspire, encourage, cajole young people to think about careers in the public arena. I go home every night more inspired about the future because of the young people who I interact with here, all very bright, but more than that, young people who believe that they have a responsibility to shape the future and not just live in it. And as I look out at all of you, I see more potential leaders and more potential participants in our program. So I'm really, really pleased to see you and your parents here today. So when I decided to start the Institute of Politics, I knew that I needed the help of really smart and experienced colleagues and friends. And you have an assemblage of them here today who are on our board of advisors. We happen to be having our board of advisors meeting today. We had a great meeting, lots of great ideas for the future, but we decided to come over here today and have a little bit of a discussion about the midterm elections, which are just a few weeks away. But let me introduce these folks to you, because it'll give you a sense of the kind of people who pass through the Institute of Politics on a regular basis. Here we have Robert Gibbs, my old partner in crime, which is how my Republican friends refer to us. former press secretary to President Obama. Larry Grisolano, one of the great Democratic strategists in the country. And I'd say that even if he didn't run the company that I started years ago. But Larry was really the director of our message and research operations in both Obama campaigns, and really did a masterful job and helped push the envelope on on the technology and the approach that we take to campaigns. Ray LaHood was for years a great, great congressman from the Peoria area, Republican congressman. He left to become Secretary of Transportation in the Obama administration, and now he is splitting his time between Washington and Illinois. I should mention that his son is now a state senator in the Peoria area, so he's doing his part to create a new generation of leadership. Next to him is Isaac Lee, who is the head of the news division at Univision and the chief executive officer of the Fusion Network, which has just started as a joint venture with the ABC network to reach younger viewers around the country, perhaps some of you. Mike Murphy is one of the great Republican strategists in the country. He and I have had many, many encounters over the years. I still have the scars to show for it. Really a wonderful, public-spirited, great guy. Neera Tanden runs the Center for American Progress, CAP, and was when we met, she was a policy aide to then First Lady Hillary Clinton and one of the great policy thinkers in the country. And Howard Wolfson, who worked in politics for Senator Clinton and others, went to work for Mayor Bloomberg in New York, became deputy mayor, and still works with Mayor Bloomberg today, having left office and on to other things, but very active still in politics and public life. So let me just frame the discussion. First of all, give him a hand, will you? We had this meeting this morning, and I looked around the room and I thought how blessed we are to have people of such talent and such character to help foment ideas for the IOP and to help us become better. So we're really grateful to all of them. Let me start this discussion. We have this election in 3 weeks. The big question on people's minds is control of the United States Senate. That seems to be the main story. There are other stories that we may get to, but let's start with that one. And let me start with an easy question for the entire panel. This is a raise your hand thing. I know we've had a bad history with this raising of hand kind of questions, but how many here believe that when the smoke is clears that the Republican Party will be the majority party in the U.S. Senate after this election? Okay. So, Ray, okay, well, maybe you stunned me. I wasn't surprised that Neera sat there. But tell me why you feel the way you do.
I think in three key races where you have senators who have a long, rich history of family participation in politics, when you add that to the mix in Louisiana, where you have a U.S. senator whose brother is the mayor of New Orleans and father was mayor of New Orleans, I think those deep family ties make it difficult for people to vote against someone like that. And I think Mark Pryor is another example in Arkansas, where his father had a distinguished career of public service. And I believe in Alaska, where Mark Begich's father was also involved. Now, all three of these senators have had distinguished careers. Maybe one of the three will lose. All three will not lose, because people's heartstrings will be tugged by the idea that we have good people from good families who have really adopted public service as their opportunity to serve the public. And I think two out of three, and maybe all three, will win.
Spoken like the father of a state senator. So, Mike, do you agree with that?
Well, I want to start quickly by thanking you for having me here. I'm a little nervous because I know the political records of many of my colleagues, and being in a church is a new experience for that debate. I'm worried some holy water may start boiling in the back, but we're trying to keep this honest. I think we are likely but not certain to win the Senate, mostly because of the playing field. We're going to win the red states. I don't think any Republican incumbents, including Senator McConnell, are going to lose. So I think it'll be close. It may come down to that Louisiana race Secretary LaHood talked about, which is a runoff deal which might happen after the election. So we could be deadlocked and solve it all in Louisiana, where the politics are colorful, 30 days after the election. But I think it's about a 60-40 chance, maybe even a little better, that the Republicans will win the Senate and they will hold the House.
So what's interesting, it seems to me, there are seven states, so-called red states, states where President Obama lost to Mitt Romney, where there are Democrats holding seats today, and there are elections this year in an off-year election. In three of them, the incumbents are retiring, and there's a general consensus that those seats are going to be hard for Democrats to win. But then when you look at these other states, you've got a couple of states, Louisiana and Arkansas, where Romney won by large numbers, by a large margin, double-digit margin. And then, I'd put Alaska in that category as well. Then you've got these purple states. You've got North Carolina, where Obama lost by just 2 points. You've got Iowa and Colorado. Iowa, where there's a vacant seat, Senator Harkin retiring. Colorado, where you have a Democratic incumbent, Mark Udall. Those races are very close. If you look at the polls right now, you would say these races are all following true to form. In other words, states that are deeper red are more distressed for Democratic incumbents. States that are toss-up states in presidential races are toss-up states in these Senate races. That would lead you to believe that Republicans would win. But Larry, I know you feel strongly about this predestination thing.
Yeah, I think that there's, if you look at how the ones that are currently, nobody would argue where they're going, every single Obama, blue state, Obama state is going to the Democratic Senator, every Senate candidate, every single locked Republican is going to the Republican Senate candidate, the Romney side. And so the ones in the middle are where we're gonna determine whether this trend holds. And ultimately, when you look at the race, what's really there to shake people up and make them sort of move out of that partisan trend that they're in? Secretary LaHood says, well, on an individual basis, people will be drawn to the candidates because of their history in the state. And they may, in fact, go that way. As I look at the polling now, in those states, the Republicans are all ahead. And I think what's going to happen when it's finally said and done is there will be a little bit of a Republican turnout effect that's going to take that difference in the polling and help the Republicans even more. And so I think we're ultimately going to end up with a states kind of falling into exactly where they were in the presidential campaign, with a couple of exceptions that might that might buck the trend, but those exceptions are in very, very close states. And ultimately, you say, why do we run these elections? You could have predicted which way these states would go.
Well, let me add, one of the reasons why people, in addition to the playing field, people believe that maybe these elections would shade Republican is turnout. And you hinted at that. There are a third less voters who participate in these midterm elections than presidential elections. And they tend to be disproportionately Democrats, minority voters, younger voters. I just want to stay with you for 1 second, Larry. You were very much involved in this whole use of big data, micro-targeting, to really target voters in battleground states for President Obama for special attention. Talk a little bit about that, and do you believe that that's applicable in these elections? Democrats have invested $50 million or more in micro-targeting efforts in some of these states. Could that make the difference in some of these elections?
Yeah, I would say A couple of things. It's true that there generally are more Democratic drop-offs than Republican drop-offs, but it's not always true. For instance, we had a really good, I'm speaking as a Democrat, had a really good election year in 2006, an off-year election, where Republicans were sort of demoralized about Bush, Democrats were growing weary of the war, excited for an opportunity to kind of change the Bush politics. So we had Democrats kind of benefited from the off-year turnout. We had the enthusiasm that year. In terms of how the ability to kind of tactically affect the outcome of these things with the targeting and with the organizational activities that the Democrats, I think in most cases, still have a clear advantage in, I think that we can get a couple of points by our ability to do that, but not enough to overcome if our candidate's already a couple points down and the natural direction of turnout already costs us a couple of points. A really quick example of this, in Iowa, where very early in the presidential cycle, Democrats had this big advantage in terms of absentee ballot applications. And we knew in the Obama side of things that we were gonna have a big advantage coming into the ultimate outcome of the race because of those absentee ballots that Democrats in Iowa opened up as an advantage. And in fact, that did turn out to be larger than the margin of victory in Iowa. Here, this year, Democrats once again have that organizational advantage. More people, more Democrats, and Democratic-leaning independents have requested absentee ballots. We will end up with a marginal benefit, a couple of points because of that. It's just not clear to me whether that's going to be big enough to overcome the natural inclinations of the electorate in an off year where they're not particularly excited about Democrats.
Isaac, I mentioned that a lot of the drop-off is among minority voters. You run networks that are geared toward the Hispanic communities around the country. What is your sense of the level of interest in this election on the part of these communities? And what does it say to you about the kind of turnout that we can anticipate in November?
It's not very high. I think there's a lot of disillusionment from the Latino community. The fact that immigration reform has not passed for whatever reason makes them hopeless. And I think that most of the big issues for the Latino community are federal issues. And so when there is a presidential campaign, there's a lot more of participation. When it's more about local politics or when they are choosing Congress or Senate, it's harder to call their interest. I also think that it's a very boring campaign. It's hard to find exciting candidates. And it is happening at a time where the perception for Washington politicians, institutions is very, very low. And at the end of the day, it's these communities going back home and thinking if their participation can change anything in their lives. And if that is not part of the equation, then there is really no reason why. And I think it is also happening with young people. They are finding out that there are other different ways that they want to participate to change the world than just what they perceive is a failing political system.
We have this discussion a lot here because obviously one of our missions here is to make the case that it is worth participating in the process. And I always make the same case, which is that Congress is going to meet with these young people or without them, going to make decisions that are really relevant to their concerns in their lives. Immigration reform is one of them. Let me just ask you, what is the perception? You say it hasn't passed for whatever reason. Is there more of a sense that that's because of the president, because of the Republican Congress, or is it just a pox on both their houses?
We just did a poll, and results came out last week. And what is surprising is not that the blame is on a Republican Congress. What it's surprising is that it's not enough. I mean, it's not as bad as it should be. So then the question is, if the blame is distributed in those percentages, is it worthwhile for the RNC to change and to have a different point of view if they are going to pay the price in the primaries? So let's say that my concern is not that they don't identify where the blame is, it is that it's not as much as it should be.
Howard, you work for an independent, or you've worked for an independent mayor of New York, started as a Republican, became an independent, and you've supported candidates, you being the entity Bloomberg, have supported candidates, Republican and Democrat. But you listen to this conversation, and it's hard to hear where sort of the independent voter fits in, and where they go, and what is the where is there a home for someone who isn't necessarily down the line Republican, down the line Democrat? Are you feeling uncomfortable?
Well, I'm feeling a little uncomfortable because, to Mike's point, the last time I was in this church was 25 years ago, watching the rest of my class graduate without me. So. it's good to be back under better
circumstances.
You'll
get the honorary degree at the end of the program.
I did eventually get there, yes. And none of you will make the mistake that I made. You will all graduate on time. I guess I'd say a couple of things. One, you do have two states, South Dakota and Kansas, in which independent candidates are attracting a fair amount of attention from voters. And in one instance in Kansas is actually leading in the polls against a Republican incumbent, which you would not imagine a set of circumstances like that typically in Kansas, where a Republican incumbent is behind. And I think that that reflects two realities. One is that, unlike Democrat or Republican running in those states, the independent has not been the recipient of millions of dollars worth of negative ads dumped on their heads over the past year or so. So they come, as we hit the home stretch now in October, they come in relatively unscathed by that kind of negative advertising. But I think the larger point is that there are a lot of people who are looking for an alternative outside of the two-party system. And I am still a Democrat, unlike my boss, and I'm proud to be one, but I do think that it often appears as if the two-party political system is failing voters. And in some of these states where the campaigns are so divisive and vituperative, and both sides seem to be appealing only towards their base and basist instincts, there is a real hunger for an alternative that can be filled by an independent. I guess the other point I'd make is that there are some states in the past several years that have passed either nonpartisan redistricting or nonpartisan elections or both. And we are, my boss is currently involved in an effort to pass nonpartisan elections in Oregon, which is going to be on the ballot this November there. And I think you are seeing in many places, I wouldn't say a wholesale rejection, but an awful lot of unhappiness with the two-party system, and certainly a willingness to entertain candidates and processes outside of the traditional two-party system.
If Orman were to win in Kansas, do you think that will spawn imitators, independent candidates running in the next cycle?
Well,
and what about for president?
We had an independent candidate win in Maine 2 years ago under circumstances that were not dissimilar to the ones that are being faced in Kansas now, where there was a relatively strong Republican, a very weak Democrat, and an independent posing the most significant challenge to the Republican. We supported Angus King in Maine, and frankly, were disappointed that he chose to caucus with the Democrats as opposed to remaining a caucus of one. Many people think that that was unrealistic, but there was some expectation that he might just sort of hold himself back from both parties. If Orman is successful in Kansas, or Pressler is successful in South Dakota, less likely, or both, you may have an opportunity for the independents in the Senate to actually form a meaningful independent caucus and not caucus with either Republican or Democrat. And if that happened, I do think you would see an awful lot of independents stepping forward and considering races for the Senate in 2016. Presidential campaign is much more complicated because it requires so much more money.
But your guy has money.
I'm sorry?
Your guy has money.
He does. He has. No, he has said that he's not going to run in 2016, and I have seen nothing to indicate that he's changed his mind. So
there was an independent senator in the it must have been in the 60s when Wayne Morse put his chair in between the two aisles from Oregon, switched from the Republican Party to.
You could do it. You could, you know, constantly sort of shift back and forth between the two parties depending on what you thought the parties were doing at that particular moment on the issues you cared about.
You'd have to have your chair on wheels, probably. Mike Murphy, on this subject, what's the matter with Kansas? The lost that state by, I think, 23 points, and you've got an incumbent Republican senator who's even or behind an independent candidate there. Explain that.
Well, it's one of these things where I think it'll be clear on Election Day, and Kansas is going to, I think, vote to reelect Pat Roberts. If the election were held today, the independent would win, Greg Orman. So you can take a couple of views on this. I think the most accurate one is Senator Roberts was, I'll say as a partisan Republican, so busy with the great issues in Washington that he didn't get back to Kansas that much and pretty much lived in D.C. He had a very strong primary challenge from the kind of movement conservative faction, which he prevailed in. But his connection to the state was a little weakened. Greg Orman is a very smart guy, was able to run kind of a well-funded campaign doing the independent brand. Now, I have a weakness for kind of independent candidates, but sometimes it's a little cynical. You know, I'm independent because on that controversial issue, I'm still thinking about it, because you don't want to offend either side. Orman refuses to say which side he'd caucus with. I don't want to be part of Harry Reid, and I don't want to be part of Mitch McConnell. I'll explain after the election. That kind of thing works well in the short term. In the longer term, like the next 3 weeks, I think the electron microscope of, wait a minute, take a stand, is going to be upon him. I think the Republican Party is going to dump a gazillion dollars in negative advertising on the guy, because the highest sin in practical politics is to lose a seat you're supposed to get easy. And I think Pat Roberts will reconnect with the state very aggressively. So my guess is this is reminds me of the Scottish referendum a little bit. It was important to Scots to see polls showing that a majority of them are ready to break away and get properly pandered to, and then they were happy not to break away. I think the good Republican voters of the great state of Kansas would do the same, but election were held today, we'd lose. And quickly on Larry Pressler, I don't think he's going to...
South Dakota.
Yeah, that's the other independent candidate.
Former Republican senator from...
bit of a poll. He was a senator before. You might remember from American Hustle, he was the one guy who said no to a bribe. That would be illegal. And then he ran for president on that, and he didn't win. He's trying for a comeback now. He is a friend of mine. I did his last successful reelection campaign because Bob Dole made me, and I don't think he's going to win. The one that could be the upset is Orman, though I think the odds are 2-1 against.
Now, Neera, you didn't raise your hand when I said who believes there's going to be a Republican Senate, and that was duly noted. We'll send word back to Washington that you kept your hand at your side.
I'll send word back to Washington about your position on this.
I have not taken a position. I'm just asking questions. Let's talk for a second on the off chance that there is a Republican Senate. Mm-hmm. You're a policy person. Do you see significant impacts on policy in the next 2 years? And let me posit a hypothetical here. Could it be, or a theory I should say, could it be that the Republican Party now fully in control has some pressure to try and produce and therefore will want to do some things with the president, whereas we've seen less of an interest in doing that in the last few years?
So, you know, I think the big challenge that we have, that everyone has talked about, but I guess I'll put a slightly different frame on, is that, you know, Washington isn't functioning. Now, you could say that I think Republicans on this panel would say that it's a pox in both houses. You know, things, neither the president isn't coming to the middle and the right isn't coming to the middle from a kind of progressive perspective. I think the Tea Party has shifted things very far right. The House Republican Caucus certainly hasn't passed an immigration bill that passed out of the Senate. But just stepping back, we don't have major issues on the table in this election because Washington seems incapable of doing very basic things. I think that is a problem for Democratic turnout. So I don't think these races are easy, et cetera. But I do think the fact that, you know, Democrats think that there are problems in the country that need to be solved, right? And Washington isn't offering solutions. That is a problem for Democratic turnout. I mean, the big question over the next 2 years is, as we face a Republican presidential primary, will the incentives for the Republican Congressional Party change, right? Will they say, oh, we want to get it helps to pass things with this president. We want to get reelected. We don't want to face a Republican primary that in many of these races has been the hardest race Republican electeds have faced. So we're going to try and get things done. Over the last couple of years, we've seen that doing anything with the president is Republican primary bait. So I'm not an expert on the Republican Party by any measure. I will defer to others at this table, but it does not seem to me that having won the Senate, the leaders of the power in the party will be, now's the time to strike a deal. It may be that presidential candidates want to seem more reasonable, but you will have Republican presidential candidates who will argue, like Ted Cruz, who will argue that doing deals with the president is what's terrible about politics and will continue to shift the party right. So I'm not optimistic that we'll get a lot more done with Republicans coming to power. And, you know, I mean, it may be an interesting experiment, but Mike and others may have other views on that.
Well,
but
let's turn to Congressman LaHood,
yeah,
who spent, for purposes of this question, you're congressman and not secretary. You spent years in that institution. A lot of your old friends are still there. How do you think the Republican Party will respond? Because there are two theories. One is, yes, there's an impetus to cooperate more if they win. And I know you said you didn't think they would. But there's this other theory, and the one that Neera mentioned, which is that the base will draw the Republican Party to the right, won't allow a spirit of cooperation. Which way, based on your experience, do you think things would go?
Well, I think on the big issues, the Congress will not do anything for the next 2 years. There will be no immigration reform because, look, a Republican Congress is not going to want to give the president any big wins on immigration reform, on tax reform, which would help the Republican base. And on other fiscal issues like balancing the budget. I think the debates for the next 2 years will be around fighting terrorism, how do we deal with ISIL, and maybe there'll be some agreement between President Obama and a Republican-controlled Congress. But on the big issues, the issues that people really care about, the bread and butter issues that affect middle-income people, there will be no resolution, and we will muddle along. There may be debates and committee hearings and so forth, but they will not be resolved. They will be a part of the presidential campaign, and that'll continue to be very bad for the country.
Robert Gibbs, you and I were in the White House during a very active period in the first 2 years of the presidency. the midterms of 2010 changed the playing field a little bit. As you look ahead, you did have your hand up and when I asked who would control the Senate. What is your, as someone who has been an aide to the president, how do you think about these next 2 years from his perspective, given the possibility of an all-Republican Congress?
Well, it's a very good question, and I think we're likely to see this have to come to a head somewhat quickly. And I think the White House will have to determine whether there is a honeymoon period of engagement with Republicans to see and test Congressman LaHood's theory on whether or not something can get done. That will also bump up against the need or the desire on what was talked about on immigration to do something executively and try to put some wins on the board. And by wins, I mean legacy items, whether it's whether it is something around immigration reform, whether it's something like the Wall Street Journal talked about last week, closing the prison at Guantanamo Bay. I think there'll be a push and a pull inside the administration to figure out how do we go about doing that. I agree with the congressman that I think it's hard to see how somehow this is the year that will break the logjam and you'll have this tremendous flood of good feelings and compromise. I think if you're a Republican in the Congress, you're thinking to yourself, I think I'd rather put my chips in the table and hope for a Republican president that I can do business with rather than somehow try to make incremental progress on something that doesn't turn them away. You know, Howard mentioned something I think is important, which is redistricting. And one of the reasons I think it's a thread through a lot of our comments, 20 years ago, right after the 1992 election, there were what political scientists thought of as a little more than 100 swing districts. And those are districts that were represented, the vote in those districts was within 5 percentage points of what you see nationally, right? So in a 52-48 or 51-49 country, they're not big margins, right? And the number of sort of way out of whack districts was much smaller. 20 years later, so after the 2012 election, looking at those very same electoral numbers, there were a little bit more than 30 of those. So you've seen this huge change in the real estate, not just in Senate races about what's red and blue and purple, but in districts where, quite frankly, right now, you'd be much more concerned as a Republican, not about a Democrat that might beat you because you won your seat by 20 points and it's way different than a national election score. You'd be much, much more concerned about losing a primary. And if you're worried about losing a primary, you're not likely to buy a table like this and sit down and have a discussion about how you can fix an issue if it means compromise.
I mean, we just haven't had an experience with too many Democratic senators or Democratic House members losing in primaries, right? It's just a weird aberration between the parties that the rise of the primary has become powerful in one side versus another. Now, that might be because the Democratic Party has moved so far left or something. But if you actually look at like statistics on these things, Democratic candidates do not face the only race they have in their primary as it's in statewide offices. And so I think that has really reshaped politics. In the 90s, we didn't have primaries playing such a critical role as they do now. And certainly primaries weren't, you know, you didn't shake in fear from a primary when you, made a deal with the opposing party.
Mike, let me ask you a question as a once and perhaps future presidential strategist.
Sure.
As you look at this Republican Senate, you've heard the discussion. If you were to advise the Republican caucus on what they could best do to support the possibility of a Republican president in 2016, what would it be?
I get back into the middle class economics business. The issue we have is in both parties, Robert's absolutely right, the primary voters do have most of the power because we don't have swing districts anymore. We used to have a House where the ideological spread between the most liberal Republican and most conservative Democrat was 90 congressmen. Now it's 6. So that has kind of clogged up the system. And in both parties, I disagree, well, I kind of agree with the premise that it'll be hard for the Republicans to get anything done next year because the primary season begins in an hour. But the Democrats also have an open primary. They have an overwhelming super front runner, but the energy in the Democratic Party is every bit on the left. We just had a lab experiment electing a new mayor of New York, and we've got a great patriot who loves his country who also has a tattoo that says, I heart Trotsky. The energy in that primary totally came out of nowhere from the left, and the front runner got wiped out.
Have you actually seen this tattoo?
No, it's only in my dream journal of nightmares. So the point is,
Mike,
Hillary Clinton's going to have...
What's the tattoo Mike Murphy has? That's the dream journal.
Bush for president. Jeb Bush for president. So the problem is the incentives of the system, and incentives are powerful, are against getting anything done in D.C. other than passing a budget every year because the interest groups murder you if you don't do that. And that's the logjam that only the voters can break, but the voters tend to line up in these safe districts and vote for their side or their interest group.
Yeah, Larry, let me ask you about that. What responsibility do voters have in all this? We speak of them as if they're just sort of, you know, chattel here. What is their responsibility?
Well, we do have an election this year where voters would have an opportunity to make this a referendum on a Congress that has done nothing, and unfortunately, at the moment, people revert more to their kind of partisan norm, and they for whatever reason aren't angry enough yet to say, I don't really care whether this is a Democratic incumbent or a Republican incumbent. If I feel that nothing's getting done, I'm going to punish them. And so that hasn't become the thing that motivates people's votes yet, because they are, in fact, as Robert described and others have described, still kind of, at the moment, really locked into partisanship for their decisions. I don't think that's necessarily something that will never change. There's clearly an anger out there, and it may be that they respond to that kind of message, or it may be we get candidates that either independents, as Howard was talking about, or people from within parties who try and switch up the math and take advantage of this this anger.
Part of it is turnout, though, isn't it? I mean, the fact is that it's not just that people are turning out and making partisan decisions. A lot of people are making the decision not to vote at all.
That's right. But again, that's really an expression that it's not important enough to them to go out and take on what they perceive as a problem. And the fact is, overwhelmingly, people in the polls, people say it is Republicans in the House that are holding things up from getting done. It's not that it's lost on them. It's that they just haven't decided to make that a voting issue.
But what's interesting is that there's also, as you look at the research, there's a great deal of anger at the president because he hasn't been able to overcome that.
That's right.
So it's not, you know, it's not cut and dry.
Well, as I said, at the Bloomberg Foundation, we're trying to promote nonpartisan elections and nonpartisan redistricting. And
explain how that works,
sure.
Especially the nonpartisan elections.
Yeah. So typically we have elections in the following manner. Republican Party voters vote for Republican candidate. Democratic Party voters vote for the Democratic candidate, and the Democrat and the Republican meet in November. The primary election would have occurred sometimes 3 months earlier, 4 months, 5 months, 6 months, what have you. Occasionally, there are states that will allow what is called crossover voting, where a registered Democrat could vote in the Republican primary or vice versa, but many more states have primaries that are essentially closed. Only Democrats can vote for the Democratic candidate. Only Republicans can vote for the Republican candidate. Some states, the biggest of which is California, have passed nonpartisan elections at the state level. Many more municipalities have had them at the municipal level for a very long time. And what happens in a nonpartisan election is you have the primary in, let's say, March or April or May. All voters, regardless of party, come out and vote for all of the candidates on one ballot. And whoever finishes one and two, regardless of party, face each other in November. And the theory behind that is that you might get, instead of just a Republican and a Democrat in November, you might get two Democrats or two Republicans, depending on the district, and have an actual contest between a moderate Republican and a more conservative Republican, or a more liberal Democrat with a more moderate Democrat in the general election. Nonpartisan redistricting, typically redistricting is done every 10 years to determine what the contours of a congressional district or a state legislative district are that any particular candidate can represent or run in. These are typically done behind closed doors in the proverbial smoke-filled rooms where legislators of each party at the state level draw districts to maximize either safe Republican seats or safe Democratic seats or both, depending on the state. Some states have taken a look at that and said this is not a great way to run our democracy, and so they have tried to take redistricting away from the politicians who end up running in these districts by turning it over to a committee of citizens or a committee of judges. So in states where you have both nonpartisan elections and nonpartisan redistricting, which they now have in California, you are seeing some additional competitive elections in districts that typically did not have competitive elections because they were either overwhelmingly Democratic or overwhelmingly Republican. And so we think this is a good thing and we ought to be promoting this. But to your question of who's at fault here, the one caution I would add is that we as Americans are doing more and more self-segregating ourselves. So nonpartisan redistricting and nonpartisan elections can get at some of that. But the fact is, if you have Democrats cluster with other Democrats and Republicans cluster with other Republicans, and you can think about your own neighborhoods and think about whether that's true in the places where you live, where in many parts of the country, 70 or 80% of your neighbors are either one party or another, that's about us. That's about American choices and we make as citizens and not necessarily about the political process and the way it's structured.
Robert?
Well, and I would just I'd look the numbers up, but I think are instructive. Again, swing districts 20 years ago, there were 103. After the 2012 election, there were 35. Districts that were considered landslide Democrat or landslide Republican districts, so that's 20%, 20 points different, 20 points more Democratic or 20 points more Republican than the country as a whole. Went from 123 20 years ago to 242 after the 2012 election. That's more than half of Congress lives in a place in which the president gets 51%, but a congressman or congresswoman gets 71%. And as Mike said, that tends to be where the energy is. And if that's where the energy is, it leaves this huge hole in the middle.
In the party primaries,
I think in party primaries, but I also think in some ways in the discussion of issues,
mm-hmm.
right? I think, you know, if you have a Democrat that wants to do something with a Republican, they may not get primaried, but they may get 10,000 nasty emails. And those aren't organic emails. I just think what you've done in this, you know, over the course of 20 years is you just have taken through a series of wave elections, you've taken a lot of the middle out. You've taken a lot of people that are going to be your deal cutters, your Rayla Hoods have left Congress.
Just one quick thing on this, while we're assigning blame, I think how we're consuming news these days is part of how this is all working. Because there was a moment when the internet arrived when people started saying, this is this great democratizing tool where people can sort things out and find the answers and make more rational choices. And what's happened is the exact opposite, both on cable television and on the internet. People are sort of sorting themselves into their corners, and they're in order to get people to attract people to their own corner, the networks and the internet sites are making themselves, they're screaming louder and becoming more extreme, and that's sort of feeding into, there's these structural reasons that that Robert's describing, and then there's this whole echo chamber that's serving that extremism that is causing this kind of logjam.
I want to take some questions from the audience. I just want to finish up with one question for Isaac on this issue of redistricting. One of the things that happened over the course of the last so many years is that we made a decision as a country, and the courts made a decision based on the Voting Rights Act that minorities were underrepresented. We ought to create districts to allow greater minority representation in the Congress, a laudable goal. But one of the ancillary effects of that is that you're removing minorities from all the other districts in order to create these minority districts. So you have, in the vast majority of districts, Republican districts, very few, for example, Latino voters, often very few black voters. So the question is about the trade-off. What have we given up in order to create these minority districts? And what's the right balance?
I don't know what the right balance is, but if there is nothing to lose for a candidate because there aren't enough constituents in a district, then something's really wrong. And if you add to that the efforts that are made sometimes for these minorities not to vote, then there is really a big problem. So I don't know what the right balance is, but I do know that to have a small percentage of minorities in any district that really don't represent reality, it's not right.
Jim, you've got the
microphone.
So do we have questions here? Got a whole bunch of hands up here.
I know.
Deans can run, come on.
Hi, my question is for Mr. Wolfson. On the bipartisan system, one thing that people argue is that it's much more stable than not having that two-party system. How would you respond to that?
Well, I do think you see in other countries that have a more vigorous multi-party system some greater churn. So in countries in Europe where you have third and fourth and fifth parties that are more active and are given an opportunity to gain power through the nature of the system, you do have situations where an extreme party, for instance, like you see, let's say in a country like Greece, can get 18-20% of the vote and actually have a meaningful representation in the assembly, in the parliament, or you see in France where the party of Le Pen is in a position to gain more prominence because of the way the system works. So, yes, there is some truth to that. I think, you know, we are so far away from that in this country that providing a little bit more opportunity for some greater diversity of candidates and views in parties would be a good thing. So I think it is a fair question, and it's a concern in some parts of the world. But it seems to me that in this country our problem is the opposite, that we have two parties that frequently put up people on both extremes, and there's just not enough coming together in the middle.
I'm gonna get that. Yeah. Get to a student real fast. Okay.
This is how the dean gets exercise.
Hi. Oh. My question is just for everyone here. Do you think that the Electoral College helps our democracy, or does it do a disservice to our citizens by not allowing popular vote for the presidency?
When I was in Congress, I introduced a constitutional amendment to elect the president by popular vote. The problem is one time it passed in the House of Representatives. It will never pass in the Senate because the small state senators will never vote for it.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on.
We would like to associate our remarks with what the congressman just said.
All right, so this is a bit of a two-part question. I think that's sort of allowed. Do you agree that large companies and special interest groups exert a great degree of control over our Congress, our elections, and the entire political system? And if you agree with that statement, what should be done to change that? That's for anybody out there.
Well, we should have a two-part answer. We should let Neera and Murphy each have a chance to answer this question.
I'll answer the first, yes.
I'll answer half the first. Interest groups, yes. Large corporations, overrated as far as their influence, but that's a very popular narrative. Actually, corporate political expenditure has not been nearly as large as people suspected. It's been wealthy individuals on both sides that really fueled it. And what do you do about it? Voters should vote to punish it if they don't like it. I'm not for arbitrary limits on speech.
Anybody else want to engage on this? Should we move
okay.
on?
Yep.
This question is also for anyone on the panel. Do you think any of President Obama's recent policies and decisions, either domestic or foreign, are to the advantage of either party going into the midterms? And if so, do you think it will be enough to make a difference on the final outcome of the elections?
Why don't you answer that, Axelrod?
I'm just moderating.
It's good to have Senator Orman here from Kansas. I'll just say this. His favorable rating is down to 41, and Broccoli's at 44. That's not a good position to be in a midterm election.
I mean, obviously, look, I think if you're a Democrat or a Democratic strategist, your theory on this is, and you saw Mike's answer on what would a Republican presidential candidate be talking about, which is middle-class economics. Instead, we're talking about terrorism and foreign policy, and those are traditionally issues that have not favored Democrats. And I think, you know, for a lot of reasons why I answered the Senate would go Republican, one of them is I think the issue terrain has moved away from what Democrats ought to be or want to be discussing, and on to a series of foreign policy and terrorism issues that, while they're certainly suited to discuss, it's not something that is going to excite a lot of people going into this race.
Follow-on question for the panel. At the beginning of the year, the Republican mantra was that the Affordable Care Act was going to be the decisive issue in the election. Does anybody here feel that it will be? And if not, why not?
It's big, but I don't think it's the only issue. And to some extent, it's built into the thing now. It's kind of played out. If you're a base Democratic voter, you're pretty okay on the ACA. If you're a base Republican voter, you don't like it. The question is persuadable voters. It is more of a political problem, I think, in most places than a positive, at least the data I show. But I think now the election's about a couple of things and it's one, but I think the media might have gotten one beat bigger than reality on that. But you can't say it's a small issue because it is a big issue and it is unpopular if the voters account.
Larry, you're out there. Are you seeing it?
I think the Republicans in the beginning of this cycle had hoped it would be because of its unpopularity, as Mike points out. It could have been, but they so damaged their image in the extreme way that they used the ACA to obstruct things in Congress, the extreme rhetoric, that it basically helped create this image that people, the thing that people don't like about Republicans. So they kind of neutered themselves in their ability to use it, but because by raising it, they sort of raised their own, the specter of their own negatives, so they've moved on to other issues.
I mean, the ACA is just not, there are just not that much ad money on ACA right now. I mean, there definitely was earlier in the cycle, but it could be completely baked in, so it doesn't make any sense to advertise it. But if you just look at the numbers of dollars on the ACA or that mention the ACA, it's plummeted.
But Neera, let me ask you this, because you're very conversant in the ACA, and you obviously are fluent in the benefits of the ACA. Why is it that opposition is more motivated than supporters? Why aren't more Democrats positively motivated by the ACA to want to vote?
I mean, the ACA still is touching, like, out of the population, relatively few people. Most people have insurance. I think the ACA has become, for the conservative base, an effective way to rail against the size of government and things like that. You do see with pockets of groups that are very important for Democrats, single women, Latinos. They self-identify the ACA. They mention the ACA itself as a positive. Whether this will change as more and more people know people who've been affected, I don't know. I would definitely agree that it is not. It has not been a helpful political tool. But when you're talking about even 7 million, 10 million, 15 million people getting insurance through the ACA, that's still like a drop in the bucket and not well distributed. It's heavily represented in very blue states like New York, California, that have done a very good job with expansion, very underrepresented in red states that have chosen not to do expansions.
So. Although one state that's well represented is Kentucky.
Yeah.
I noticed that Senator McConnell has not been railing against
it. And Alison Grimes is not discussing it, even though the state has been very successful.
Other questions?
Hi, so my question is for the panel in general. I was reading a few articles in like the New York Times and The Economist saying that a lot of the low congressional approval ratings and political polarization of Congress is due in large part to political apathy amongst the American people. And so my question is, what is your response to that?
I guess we're a little apathetic. No, there's cynicism. There's a polling number we all watch called the right track, wrong track. The country's going the right direction, or we think things are pretty seriously off on the wrong track. We've been stuck in the 60s to the all-time high of 80 on wrong track for many years now. People, the whole category of politics is under attack. People don't like it. There's an interesting poll question. Would you fire? The old thing used to be, I hate Congress, but what about your guy? Oh, I love my guy. I got the one good one. Now I saw a piece of POS data, 60% say everybody ought to be fired, including their own congressman. That number used to be in the 30s. So the category is definitely under assault and people are cynical, but I think we're going to have average turnout for an off-year election. And in the presidential year, we'll have average big turnout. So I'm not sure they've really expressed it. That because each side has a boogeyman, and you can turn into a channel of news that tells you you're right. All the problem are those bad Republicans in Oklahoma with their guns and fried food. And, you know, you can get that every night on a cable channel I won't mention. And there's another cable channel with a lot of flags on it that's going to be talking about, you know, the other side and all the terrible socialistic secret conspiracies. And you can kind of get fed information that way and be pretty happy and vote in your silo. And remember, the incentives are not to do anything. They're dug in.
I think that cable news channel talks about tattoos of Trotsky.
Hopefully they will tomorrow.
I would say one thing to watch out for, not just the unique circumstances where you have an independent that is competitive, you know, whether it's a state like South Dakota or a state like Kansas, but also look at some of the ballot numbers on election night that the Libertarian or the third candidate gets. There are a number of races right now where there's a great guy in North Carolina who's a pizza delivery guy who literally has an ad that basically, it's like a YouTube ad where he says, I didn't want to have to do this, but I'm going to run for the Senate, right? And
don't you want someone who demonstrably can deliver?
See, he needs an ad man like David Axelrod. But I think what's going to be interesting is, you know, in a normal year, maybe a Libertarian gets 1 or 2% in North Carolina. Does a Libertarian get 4 or 5%? I think the last poll I saw had him at 7. Does that become sort of a home where you're just, if none of the above were on the ballot, you'd check that twice? Does a third candidate become a home just because you're sort of rage against the machine?
Mike, you looked like you were poised.
I'm torn because I totally agree with Howard, and I'm a big supporter of opening up the markets with the single primary because it makes the market mechanism work better. But I've worked around the world a little bit, and occasionally these multi-candidate systems, you get, you know, Carrot Top gets 19%. And it gives cynicism a great place to go. I'm going to vote for the most odious jerk. There's an Italian comedian who's in the Italian elections. And so, yeah, okay, you get to say you hate the system, but ultimately what happens is nobody has anything near a majority, so the inside smoke-filled room stuff, which is where bad stuff can happen in politics, becomes even more important. I think we got to break the moat some, and we might have internet voting one day, because, see, the parties have the greatest Buffett moats of anybody. It's really hard to crack as an independent. just systemically. Internet voting could blow all that up. On the other hand, they've tried internet voting, and a great Midwestern university I will not mention cracked it in 12 minutes, and you heard, well, I'll say the University of Michigan fight song came over all the computers. It's very difficult to do, but that would be a moat cracker, and it's hard to bet long-term against the internet. So I think we're going to see an evolution here, but this idea of the multi-party thing, the case studies on it are mixed.
We have time for one more question.
How do the results of the midterm election have the potential to affect the presidential election of 2016?
Very quickly, Scott Walker, the great hero of Wisconsin. Take a quick poll here. Yeah, another bunch of Republican primary voters. He may lose. yes, exactly. McConnell's still gonna win. He was a contender, and he may not win. I think everybody else will be out there. Another reason it'll be hard to get much done in the Senate, where it's generally easier to get stuff done, is, you know, the 10% of Republican caucus are running for president in those primary incentives. So,
I will take the prerogative of the chair to say that I think some of these economic issues that we touched on are really driving a lot of this discontent and have been for a very long time. The difficulty that middle class families have in keeping up and getting ahead, the lack of economic mobility that has become, and these are not all the function of public policies, they're the function of changes in technology, changes in globalization, but it seems to me that we're in a period in our politics where there's this churning going on, just constant dissatisfaction with whomever is in office. And, you know, the great challenge for us is, can we overcome this period, find ways to work together and solve some of these problems or address some of these problems and relieve some of this pressure on the system? And our hope is that some of you young people in the audience are part of that process of making that happen, which is why we're trying to encourage you all to get in the arena in some form or fashion, or at least be engaged citizens. And we look forward to seeing many of you here next year. This is a pretty typical discussion that we have. We don't always have as many august speakers as we do here, but this is the kind of programming that we do here all the time. So we hope you'll be a part of it in the future, and we appreciate you being here today. And let's give a hand to the panel here.
Good day, David. I got a scoot.
Okay, Ray. Thank you so much.
So everyone, I would just, one more round of applause for David Axelrod, who actually made it all happen. I hope you've had a wonderful day, and I am excited to be able to introduce to you our David Axelrod. He is a University of Chicago alumnus. We are and a 35-year veteran of American politics and journalism. Prior to becoming a political consultant, David spent 8 years as a reporter and columnist for the Chicago Tribune, including a stint as the City Hall Bureau Chief. And as a political consultant, David has managed media and communication strategy for more than 150 local, state, and national campaigns, most notably serving as senior strategist to President Obama. He is a wonderful citizen of the University of Chicago and a wonderful partner for me. He's been so kind to speak at our events, and so I bring you David Axelrod.
Now can you hear me? Great. I was, in fact, a student here at the University of Chicago back in the Pleistocene era,
about 100 million years ago. It's a great, great university. But one of the things that drew me to Chicago was that Chicago, then as now, was a great political town. And even as a young person, I was interested in politics. And one of the things that I missed here was that for all the wonderful education that we got, there was no way to engage with practitioners in politics, with contemporary politics. And so I began to think, as I was winding down my career in campaigns, that it would be great to bring an Institute of Politics back here to the University of Chicago to give students a chance to interact with practitioners, to talk not just about issues in politics, but also to learn a little bit about different aspects of engagement in the political arena, in public policy. We opened up in January of 2013. Since that time, we've had well over 250 speakers here, ranging from Vice President Biden and Governor Jeb Bush I should have a list in front of me, to an array of really interesting people across the political spectrum. It's been an extraordinary experience for me, primarily because of the young people who I've interacted with, because ultimately our mission is to inspire, encourage, cajole young people to think about careers in the public arena. I go home every night more inspired about the future because of the young people who I interact with here, all very bright, but more than that, young people who believe that they have a responsibility to shape the future and not just live in it. And as I look out at all of you, I see more potential leaders and more potential participants in our program. So I'm really, really pleased to see you and your parents here today. So when I decided to start the Institute of Politics, I knew that I needed the help of really smart and experienced colleagues and friends. And you have an assemblage of them here today who are on our board of advisors. We happen to be having our board of advisors meeting today. We had a great meeting, lots of great ideas for the future. But we decided to come over here today and have a little bit of a discussion about the midterm elections, which are just a few weeks away. But let me introduce these folks to you, because it'll give you a sense of the kind of people who pass through the Institute of Politics on a regular basis. Here we have Robert Gibbs, my old partner in crime, which is how my Republican friends refer to us. former press secretary to President Obama. Larry Grisolano, one of the great Democratic strategists in the country. And I'd say that even if he didn't run the company that I started years ago. But Larry was really the director of our message and research operations in both Obama campaigns, and really did a masterful job and helped push the envelope on on the technology and the approach that we take to campaigns. Ray LaHood was for years a great, great congressman from the Peoria area, Republican congressman. He left to become Secretary of Transportation in the Obama administration, and now he is splitting his time between Washington and Illinois. I should mention that his son is now a state senator in the Peoria area, so he's doing his part to create a new generation of leadership. Next to him is Isaac Lee, who is the head of the news division at Univision and the chief executive officer of the Fusion Network, which has just started as a joint venture with the ABC network to reach younger viewers around the country, perhaps some of you. Mike Murphy is one of the great Republican strategists in the country. He and I have had many, many encounters over the years. I still have the scars to show for it. Really a wonderful, public-spirited, great guy. Neera Tanden runs the Center for American Progress, CAP, and was when we met, she was a policy aide to then First Lady Hillary Clinton and one of the great policy thinkers in the country. And Howard Wolfson, who worked in politics for Senator Clinton and others, went to work for Mayor Bloomberg in New York, became deputy mayor, and still works with Mayor Bloomberg today, having left office and on to other things, but very active still in politics and public life. So let me just frame the discussion. First of all, give him a hand, will you? We had this meeting this morning, and I looked around the room and I thought how blessed we are to have people of such talent and such character to help foment ideas for the IOP and to help us become better. So we're really grateful to all of them. Let me start this discussion. We have this election in 3 weeks. The big question on people's minds is control of the United States Senate. That seems to be the main story. There are other stories that we may get to, but let's start with that one. And let me start with an easy question for the entire panel. This is a raise your hand thing. I know we've had a bad history with this raising of hand kind of questions, but how many here believe that when the smoke is clears that the Republican Party will be the majority party in the U.S. Senate after this election? Okay. So, Ray, okay, well, maybe you stunned me. I wasn't surprised that Neera sat there. But tell me why you feel the way you do.
I think in three key races where you have senators who have a long, rich history of family participation in politics, when you add that to the mix in Louisiana, where you have a U.S. senator whose brother is the mayor of New Orleans and father was mayor of New Orleans, I think those family, deep family ties make it difficult for people to vote against someone like that. And I think Mark Pryor is another example in Arkansas, where his father had a distinguished career of public service. And I believe in Alaska, where Mark Begich's father was also involved. Now, all three of these senators have had distinguished careers. Maybe one of the three will lose. All three will not lose because people's heartstrings will be tugged by the idea that we have good people from good families who have really adopted public service as their opportunity to serve the public. And I think two out of three, and maybe all three, will win.
Spoken like the father of a state senator. So, Mike. Do you agree with that?
Well, I want to start quickly by thanking you for having me here. I'm a little nervous because I know the political records of many of my colleagues, and being in a church is a new experience for that debate. I'm worried some holy water may start boiling in the back, but we're trying to keep this honest. I think we are likely but not certain to win the Senate, mostly because of the playing field. We're going to win the red states. I don't think any Republican incumbents, including Senator McConnell, are going to lose. So I think it'll be close. It may come down to that Louisiana race Secretary LaHood talked about, which is a runoff deal which might happen after the election. So we could be deadlocked and solve it all in Louisiana, where the politics are colorful, 30 days after the election. But I think it's about a 60-40 chance, maybe even a little better, that the Republicans will win the Senate and they will hold the House.
So what's interesting, it seems to me, there are seven states, so-called red states, states where President Obama lost to Mitt Romney, where there are Democrats holding seats today, and there are elections this year in an off-year election. In three of them, the incumbents are retiring, and there's a general consensus that those seats are going to be hard for Democrats to win. But then when you look at these other states, you've got a couple of states, Louisiana and Arkansas, where Romney won by large numbers, by a large margin, double-digit margin. And then I'd put Alaska in that category as well. Then you've got these purple states. You've got North Carolina, where Obama lost by just 2 points. You've got Iowa and Colorado. Iowa, where there's a vacant seat, Senator Harkin retiring. Colorado, where you have a Democratic incumbent, Mark Udall. Those races are very close. If you look at the polls right now, you would say these races are all following true to form. In other words, states that are deeper red are more distressed for Democratic incumbents. States that are toss-up.
Elections in Oregon, which is going to be on the ballot this November there. And I think you are seeing in many places, I wouldn't say a wholesale rejection, but an awful lot of unhappiness with the two-party system and certainly a willingness to entertain candidates and processes outside of the traditional two-party system.
If Orman were to win in Kansas, do you think that will spawn imitators, independent candidates running in the next cycle?
Well,
and what about for president?
We had an independent candidate win in Maine 2 years ago under circumstances that were not dissimilar to the ones that are being faced in Kansas now, where there was a relatively strong Republican, a very weak Democrat, and an independent posing the most significant challenge to the Republican. We supported Angus King in Maine, and frankly, were disappointed that he chose to caucus with the Democrats as opposed to remaining a caucus of one. Many people think that that was unrealistic, but there was some expectation that he might just sort of hold himself back from both parties. If Orman is successful in Kansas, or Pressler is successful in South Dakota, less likely, or both, you may have an opportunity for the independents in the Senate to actually form a meaningful independent caucus and not caucus with either Republican or Democrat. And if that happened, I do think you would see an awful lot of independents stepping forward and considering races for the Senate in 2016. Presidential campaign is much more complicated because it requires so much more money.
But your guy has money.
I'm sorry?
Your guy has money.
He does. He has.
Are you going to make news here?
No. He has said that he's not going to run in 2016, and I have seen nothing to indicate that he's changed his mind. So
there was an independent senator in the it must have been in the 60s when Wayne Morse put his chair in between the two aisles. From Oregon, switch from the Republican Party to...
You could do it. You could, you know, constantly sort of shift back and forth between the two parties depending on what you thought the parties were doing at that particular moment on the issues you cared about.
You'd have to have your chair on wheels, probably. Mike Murphy, on this subject, what's the matter with Kansas? The lost that state by, I think, 23 points, and you've got an incumbent Republican senator who's even or behind an independent candidate there. Explain that.
Well, it's one of these things where I think it'll be clear on Election Day, and Kansas is going to, I think, vote to reelect Pat Roberts. If the election were held today, the independent would win, Greg Orman. So you can take a couple of views on this. I think the most accurate one is Senator Roberts was, I'll say as a partisan Republican, so busy with the great issues in Washington that he didn't get back to Kansas that much and pretty much lived in D.C. He had a very strong primary challenge from the kind of movement conservative faction, which he prevailed in, but his connection to the state was a little weakened. Greg Orman is a very smart guy, was able to run kind of a well-funded campaign doing the independent brand. Now, I have a weakness for kind of independent candidates, but sometimes it's a little cynical. You know, I'm independent because on that controversial issue, I'm still thinking about it. Because you don't want to offend either side. Orman refuses to say which side he'd caucus with. I don't want to be part of Harry Reid, and I don't want to be part of Mitch McConnell. I'll explain after the election. That kind of thing works well in the short term. In the longer term, like the next 3 weeks, I think the electron microscope of, wait a minute, take a stand, is going to be upon him. I think the Republican Party is going to dump a gazillion dollars in negative advertising on the guy because the highest sin in practical politics is to lose a seat you're supposed to get easy. And I think Pat Roberts will reconnect with the state very aggressively. So my guess is this reminds me of the Scottish referendum a little bit. It was important to Scots to see polls showing that a majority of them are ready to break away and get properly pandered to, and then they were happy not to break away. I think the good Republican voters of the great state of Kansas would do the same, but election were held today, we'd lose. And quickly on Larry Pressler, I don't think he's going to...
South Dakota.
Yeah, that's the other independent candidate.
Former Republican senator from...
bit of a poll. He was a senator before. You might remember from American Hustle, he was the one guy who said no to a bribe. That would be illegal. And then he ran for president on that, and he didn't win. He's trying for a comeback now. He is a friend of mine. I did his last successful reelection campaign because Bob Dole made me, and I don't think he's going to win. The one that could be the upset is Orman, though I think the odds are 2-1 against.
Now, Neera, you didn't raise your hand when I said who believes there's going to be a Republican Senate, and that was duly noted. We'll send word back to Washington that you kept your hand at your side.
I'll send word back to Washington about your position on this.
I have not taken a position. I'm just asking questions. Let's talk for a second on the off chance that there is a Republican Senate. Mm-hmm. You're a policy person. Do you see significant impacts on policy in the next 2 years? And let me posit a hypothetical here. Could it be, or a theory, I should say, could it be that the Republican Party now fully in control has some pressure to try and produce and therefore will want to do some things with the president, whereas we've seen less of an interest in doing that in the last few years?
So, I think the big challenge that we have, that everyone has talked about, but I guess I'll put a slightly different frame on, is that, Washington isn't functioning. Now, you could say that I think Republicans on this panel would say that it's a pox on both houses, the president isn't coming to the middle and the right isn't coming to the middle from a kind of progressive perspective. I think the Tea Party has shifted things very far right. The House Republican Caucus certainly hasn't passed an immigration bill that passed out of the Senate. But just stepping back, we don't have major issues on the table in this election because Washington seems incapable of doing very basic things. I think that is a problem for Democratic turnout. So I don't think these races are easy, et cetera. But I do think the fact that Democrats think that there are problems in the country that need to be solved, right? And Washington isn't offering solutions. That is a problem for Democratic turnout. I mean, the big question over the next 2 years is, as we face a Republican presidential primary, will the incentives for the Republican Congressional Party change, right? Will they say, we want to get it helps to pass things with this president. We want to get reelected. We don't want to face a Republican primary that in many of these races has been the hardest race Republican electeds have faced. So we're going to try and get things done. Over the last couple of years, we've seen that doing anything with the president is Republican primary bait. So I am not an expert on the Republican Party by any measure. I will defer to others at this table. But it does not seem to me that having won the Senate, the leaders of the power in the party will be, now's the time to strike a deal. It may be that presidential candidates want to seem more reasonable, but you will have Republican presidential candidates who will argue, like Ted Cruz, who will argue that doing deals with the president is what's terrible about politics and will continue to shift the party right. So I'm not optimistic that we'll get a lot more done with Republicans coming to power. And it may be an interesting experiment, but Mike and others may have other views on that.
Well,
but
let's turn to Congressman LaHood.
Yeah.
Who spent, for purposes of this question, you're congressman and not secretary. You spent years in that institution. A lot of your old friends are still there. How do you think the Republican Party will respond? Because there are two theories. One is, yes, there's an impetus to cooperate more if they win. And I know you said you didn't think they would. But there's this other theory, and the one that Neera mentioned, which is that the base will draw the Republican Party to the right, won't allow a spirit of cooperation. Which way, based on your experience, do you think things would go?
Well, I think on the big issues, the Congress will not do anything for the next 2 years. There will be no immigration reform because, look, a Republican Congress is not going to want to give the president any big wins on immigration reform, on tax reform, which would help their help the Republican base, and on other fiscal issues like balancing the budget. I think the debates for the next 2 years will be around fighting terrorism, how do we deal with ISIL, maybe there'll be some agreement between President Obama and a Republican-controlled Congress. But on the big issues, the issues that people really care about, the bread and butter issues that affect middle-income people, there will be no resolution, and we will muddle along. There may be debates and committee hearings and so forth, but they will not be resolved. They will be a part of the presidential campaign, and that'll be continue to be very bad for the country.
Robert Gibbs, you and I were in the White House during a very active period in the first 2 years of the presidency. The midterms of 2010 changed the playing field a little bit. As you look ahead, you did have your hand up when I asked who would control the Senate. As someone who has been an aide to the president, how do you think about these next 2 years from his perspective, given the possibility of an all-Republican Congress?
Well, it's a very good question, and I think we're likely to see this have to come to a head somewhat quickly. And I think the White House will have to determine whether there is a honeymoon period of engagement with Republicans to see and test Congressman LaHood's theory on whether or not something can get done. That will also bump up against the need or the desire on what was talked about on immigration to do something executively and try to put some wins on the board. And by wins, I mean legacy items, whether it is something around immigration reform, whether it's something like the Wall Street Journal talked about last week, closing the prison at Guantanamo Bay. I think there'll be a push and a pull inside the administration to figure out how do we go about doing that. To me, it's hard to, I agree with the congressman that I think it's hard to see how somehow this is the year that will break the logjam and you'll have this tremendous flood of good feelings and compromise. I think if you're a Republican in the Congress, you're thinking to yourself, I'd rather put my chips in the table and hope for a Republican president that I can do business with rather than somehow try to make incremental progress on something that doesn't turn them away. You know, Howard mentioned something I think is important, which is redistricting. And one of the reasons I think it's a thread through a lot of our comments, 20 years ago, right after the 1992 election, there were what political scientists thought of as a little more than 100 swing districts. And those are districts that were represented, the vote in those districts was within 5 percentage points of what you see nationally, right? So in a 52-48 or 51-49 country, they're not big margins, right? And the number of sort of way out of whack districts was much smaller. 20 years later, so after the 2012 election, looking at those very same electoral numbers, there were a little bit more than 30 of those. So you've seen this huge change in the real estate, not just in Senate races about what's red and blue and purple, but in districts where, quite frankly, right now, you'd be much more concerned as a Republican, not about a Democrat that might beat you because you won your seat by 20 points and it's way different than a national election score. You'd be much, much more concerned about losing a primary. And if you're worried about losing a primary, you're not likely to buy a table like this and sit down and have a discussion about how you can fix an issue if it means compromise.
Mike, you're based on, just let me follow up.
Can I just say one thing about
yeah,
that?
Just yeah.
You know, I mean, we just haven't had an experience with too many Democratic senators or Democratic House members losing in primaries, right? We just, it's just a weird aberration between the parties that the rise of the primary has become powerful in one side versus another. Now, that might be because the Democratic Party has moved so far left or something. But if you actually look at, like, statistics on these things, Democratic candidates do not face the only race they have in their primary as it's in statewide offices. And so I think that has really reshaped politics. In the 90s, we didn't have primaries playing such a critical role as they do now. And certainly primaries weren't, you know, you didn't shake in fear from a primary when you, you know, made a deal with the opposing party.
Mike, let me ask you a question as a once and perhaps future presidential strategist.
Sure.
As you look at this Republican Senate, you've heard the discussion. If you were to advise the Republican caucus on what they could best do to support the possibility of a Republican president in 2016, what would it be?
I get back into the middle-class economics business. The issue we have is in both parties, Robert's absolutely right, the primary voters do have most of the power because we don't have swing districts anymore. We used to have a House where the ideological spread between the most liberal Republican and most conservative Democrat was 90 congressmen. Now it's 6. So that has kind of clogged up the system. And in both parties, I disagree. I kind of agree with the premise that it'll be hard for the Republicans to get anything done next year because the primary season begins in an hour. But the Democrats also have an open primary. They have an overwhelming super front runner, but the energy in the Democratic Party is every bit on the left. We just had a lab experiment electing a new mayor of New York, and we've got a great patriot who loves this country who also has a tattoo that says, "I heart Trotsky." The energy in that primary totally came out of nowhere from the left, and the front runner got wiped out.
Have you actually seen this tattoo?
No. It's only in my dream journal of nightmares. So the point is,
Mike,
Hillary Clinton's going to have...
What's the tattoo Mike Murphy has? That's the dream journal of my
nightmares. Bush for president. Jeb Bush for president. So the problem is the incentives of the system, and incentives are powerful, are against getting anything done in D.C., other than passing a budget every year because the interest groups murder you if you don't do that. And that's the logjam that only the voters can break, but the voters tend to line up in these safe districts and vote for their side or their interest group.
Yeah, Larry, let me ask you about that. What responsibility do voters have in all this? We speak of them as if they're just sort of, you know, chattel here. What is their responsibility?
Well, we do have an election this year where voters would have an opportunity to make this a referendum on a Congress that has done nothing, and unfortunately, at the moment people revert more to their kind of partisan norm, and they for whatever reason aren't angry enough yet to say, I don't really care whether this is a Democratic incumbent or a Republican incumbent. If I feel that nothing's getting done, I'm going to punish them. And so that hasn't become the thing that motivates people's votes yet, because they are, in fact, as Robert described and others have described, still kind of, at the moment, really locked into partisanship for their decisions. I don't think that's necessarily something that will never change. There's clearly an anger out there, and it may be that they respond to that kind of message, or it may be we get candidates that either independents, as Howard was talking about, or people from within parties who try and switch up the math and take advantage of this this anger.
Part of it is turnout, though, isn't it? I mean, the fact is that it's not just that people are turning out and making partisan decisions. A lot of people are making the decision not to vote at all.
That's right. That's right. But again, that's really an expression that it's not important enough to them to go out and take on what they perceive as a problem. And the fact is, overwhelmingly, people in the polls, people say it is Republicans in the House that are holding things up from getting done. It's not that it's lost on them. It's that they just haven't decided to make that a voting issue.
But what's interesting is that there's also, as you look at the research, there's a great deal of anger at the president because he hasn't been able to overcome that.
That's right.
So it's not, you know, it's not all, it's not cut and dry.
Well, as I said, at the Bloomberg Foundation, we're trying to promote nonpartisan elections and nonpartisan redistricting. And
explain how that works,
sure.
Especially the nonpartisan elections.
Yeah. So typically, we have elections in the following manner. Republican Party voters vote for Republican candidate. Democratic Party voters vote for the Democratic candidate, and the Democrat and the Republican meet in November. The primary election would have occurred sometimes 3 months earlier, 4 months, 5 months, 6 months, what have you. Occasionally, there are states that will allow what is called crossover voting, where a Democrat, a registered Democrat, could vote in the Republican primary or vice versa, but many more states have primaries that are essentially closed. Only Democrats can vote for the Democratic candidate. Only Republicans can vote for the Republican candidate. Some states, the biggest of which is California, have passed nonpartisan elections at the state level. Many more municipalities have had them at the municipal level for a very long time. And what happens in a nonpartisan election is you have the primary in, let's say, March or April or May. All voters, regardless of party, come out and vote for all of the candidates on one ballot. And whoever finishes one and two, regardless of party, face each other in November. And the theory behind that is that you might get, instead of just a Republican and a Democrat in November, you might get two Democrats or two Republicans, depending on the district, and have an actual contest between a moderate Republican and a more conservative Republican, or a more liberal Democrat with a more moderate Democrat in the general election. Nonpartisan redistricting, typically redistricting is done every 10 years to determine what the contours of a congressional district or a state legislative district are that any particular candidate can represent or run in. These are typically done behind closed doors in the proverbial smoke-filled rooms where legislators of each party at the state level draw districts to maximize either safe Republican seats or safe Democratic seats or both, depending on the state. Some states have taken a look at that and said this is not a great way to run our democracy, and so they have tried to take redistricting away from the politicians who end up running in these districts by turning it over to a committee of citizens or a committee of judges. So in states where you have both nonpartisan elections and nonpartisan redistricting, which they now have in California, you are seeing some additional competitive elections in districts that typically did not have competitive elections because they were either overwhelmingly Democratic or overwhelmingly Republican. And so we think this is a good thing and we ought to be promoting this. But to your question of who's at fault here, the one caution I would add is that we as Americans are doing more and more self-segregating ourselves. So nonpartisan redistricting and nonpartisan elections can get at some of that. But the fact is, if you have Democrats cluster with other Democrats and Republicans cluster with other Republicans, and you can think about your own neighborhoods and think about whether that's true in the places where you live, where in many parts of the country, 70 or 80% of your neighbors are either one party or another, that's about us. That's about American choices and we make as citizens and not necessarily about the political process and the way it's structured.
Robert?
Well, and I would just I'd look the numbers up, but I think are instructive. Again, swing districts 20 years ago, there were 103. After the 2012 election, there were 35. Districts that were considered landslide Democrat or landslide Republican districts, so that's 20%, 20 points different, 20 points more Democratic or 20 points more Republican than the country as a whole. Went from 123 20 years ago to 242 after the 2012 election. That's more than half of Congress lives in a place in which the president gets
states in presidential races are toss-up states in these Senate races. That would lead you to believe that Republicans would win. But Larry, I know you feel strongly about this predestination thing.
Yeah, I think that there's, if you look at how the ones that are currently, nobody would argue where they're going. Every single Obama, blue state, Obama state is going to the Democratic Senator. Every Senate candidate, every single locked Republican is going to the Republican Senate candidate, the Romney side. And so the ones in the middle are where we're gonna determine whether this trend holds. And ultimately, when you look at the race, what's really there to shake people up and make them sort of move out of that partisan trend that they're in? Secretary LaHood says, well, on an individual basis, people will be drawn to the candidates because of their history in the state. And they may, in fact, go that way. As I look at the polling now, in those states, the Republicans are all ahead. And I think what's going to happen when it's finally said and done is there will be a little bit of a Republican turnout effect that's going to take that difference in the polling and help the Republicans even more. And so I think we're ultimately going to end up with a states kind of falling into exactly where they were in the presidential campaign, with a couple of exceptions that might buck the trend, but those exceptions are in very, very close states. And ultimately, you say, why do we run these elections? You could have predicted which way these states would go.
Well, let me, one of the reasons why people, in addition to the playing field, people believe that maybe these elections would shade Republican is turnout. And you hinted at that. There are a third less voters who participate in these midterm elections than presidential elections. And they tend to be disproportionately Democrats, minority voters, younger voters. I just want to stay with you for one second, Larry. You were very much involved in this whole use of big data, micro-targeting, to really target voters in battleground states for President Obama for special attention. Talk a little bit about that, and do you believe that that's applicable in these elections? Democrats have invested $50 million or more in micro-targeting efforts in some of these states. Could that make the difference in some of these elections?
Yeah, I would say a couple of things. It's true that there generally are more Democratic drop-offs than Republican drop-offs, but it's not always true. For instance, we had a really good, I'm speaking as a Democrat, had a really good election year in 2006, an off-year election, where Republicans were sort of demoralized about Bush, Democrats were growing weary of the war, excited for an opportunity to kind of change the Bush politics. So we had Democrats kind of benefited from the off-year turnout. We had the enthusiasm that year. In terms of how the ability to kind of tactically affect the outcome of these things with the targeting and with the organizational activities that the Democrats, I think in most cases, still have a clear advantage in, I think that we can get a couple of points by our ability to do that, but not enough to overcome if our candidate's already a couple points down and the natural direction of turnout already costs us a couple of points. A really quick example of this, in Iowa, where very early in the presidential cycle, Democrats had this big advantage in terms of absentee ballot applications. And we knew in the Obama side of things that we were going to have a big advantage coming into the ultimate outcome of the race because of those absentee ballots that Democrats in Iowa opened up as an advantage. And in fact, that did turn out to be larger than the margin of victory in Iowa. Here this year, Democrats once again have that organizational advantage. More people, more Democrats, and Democratic-leaning independents have requested absentee ballots. We will end up with a marginal benefit, a couple of points because of that. It's just not clear to me whether that's going to be big enough to overcome the natural inclinations of the electorate in an off year where they're not particularly excited about Democrats.
Isaac, I mentioned that a lot of the drop-off is among minority voters. You run networks that are geared toward the Hispanic communities around the country. What is your sense of the level of interest in this election on the part of these communities? And what does it say to you about the kind of turnout that we can anticipate in November?
It's not very high. I think there's a lot of disillusionment from the Latino community. The fact that immigration reform has not passed for whatever reason makes them hopeless. And I think that most of the big issues for the Latino community are federal issues. And so when there is a presidential campaign, there's a lot more of participation. When it's when it's more about local politics, or when they are choosing Congress or Senate, it's harder to call their interest. I also think that it's a very boring campaign. It's hard to find exciting candidates, and it is happening at a time where the perception for Washington politicians, institutions is very, very low. And at the end of the day, it's these communities going back home and thinking if their participation can change anything in their lives. And if that is not part of the equation, then there is really no reason why. And I think it is also happening with young people. They are finding out that there are other different ways that they want to participate to change the world than just what they perceive is a failing political system.
We have this discussion a lot here because obviously one of our missions here is to make the case that it is worth participating in the process. And I always make the same case, which is that Congress is going to meet with these young people or without them. They're going to make decisions that are really relevant to their concerns in their lives. Immigration reform is one of them. Let me just ask you, what is the perception? You say it hasn't passed for whatever reason. Is there more of a sense that that's because of the president, because of the Republican Congress? Or is it just a pox on both their houses?
We just did a poll, and results came out last week. And what is surprising is not that the blame is on a Republican Congress. What is surprising is that it's not enough. I mean, it's not as bad as it should be. So then the question is if the blame is distributed in those percentages, is it worthwhile for the RNC to change and to have a different point of view if they are going to pay the price in the primaries? So let's say that my concern is not that they don't identify where the blame is, it is that it's not as much as it should be.
Howard, you work for an independent, or you've worked for an independent mayor of New York, started as a Republican, became an independent, and you've supported candidates, you being the entity Bloomberg, have supported candidates, Republican and Democrat. But you listen to this conversation, and it's hard to hear where sort of the independent voter fits in. And where they go, and what is the where is there a home for someone who isn't necessarily you know, down the line Republican, down the line Democrat? Are you feeling uncomfortable?
Well, I'm feeling a little uncomfortable because, to Mike's point, the last time I was in this church was 25 years ago, watching the rest of my class graduate without me. So. It's good to be back under better
circumstances.
You'll
get the honorary degree at the end of the program.
I did eventually get there, yes, and none of you will make the mistake that I made. You will all graduate on time. I guess I'd say a couple of things. One, you do have two states, South Dakota and Kansas, in which independent candidates are attracting a fair amount of attention from voters. and in one instance in Kansas is actually leading in the polls against a Republican incumbent, which you would not imagine a set of circumstances like that typically in Kansas where a Republican incumbent is behind. And I think that that reflects two realities. One is that unlike Democrat or Republican running in those states, the independent has not been the recipient of millions of dollars worth of negative ads dumped on their heads over the past year or so. So they come, as we hit the home stretch now in October, they come in relatively unscathed by that kind of negative advertising. But I think the larger point is that there are a lot of people who are looking for an alternative outside of the two-party system. And I am still a Democrat, unlike my boss, and I'm proud to be one, but I do think that it often appears as if the two-party political system is failing voters. And in some of these states where the campaigns are so divisive and vituperative and both sides seem to be appealing only towards their base and basist instincts, there is a real hunger for an alternative that can be filled by an independent. I guess the other point I'd make is that there are some states in the past several years that have passed either nonpartisan redistricting or nonpartisan elections or both. And we are, my boss is currently involved in an effort to pass nonpartisan.
51%, but a congressman or congresswoman gets 71%. And as Mike said, that tends to be where the energy is. And if that's where the energy is, it leaves this huge hole in the middle.
In the party primaries,
I think in party primaries, but I also think in some ways in the discussion of issues,
mm-hmm.
right? I think, you know, if you have a Democrat that wants to do something with a Republican, they may not get primaried, but they may get 10,000 nasty emails. And those aren't organic emails. I just think what you've done in this, you know, over the course of 20 years is you just have taken through a series of wave elections, you've taken a lot of the middle out. You've taken a lot of people that are gonna be your deal cutters, your Raylan Hoods of left Congress.
Just one quick thing on this, while we're assigning blame, I think how we're consuming news these days is part of how this is all working. Because there was a moment when the internet arrived when people started saying, this is this great democratizing tool where people can sort of sort things out and find the answers and make more rational choices. And what's happened is the exact opposite, both on cable television and on the internet. People are sort of sorting themselves into their corners, and in order to get people to attract people to their own corner, the networks and the internet sites are making themselves, they're screaming louder and becoming more extreme. And that's sort of feeding into, there's these structural reasons that that Robert's describing, and then there's this whole echo chamber that's serving that extremism that is causing this kind of logjam.
I want to take some questions from the audience. I just want to finish up with one question for Isaac on this issue of redistricting. One of the things that happened over the course of the last so many years is that we made a decision as a country, and the courts made a decision based on the Voting Rights Act that minorities were underrepresented. We ought to create districts to allow greater minority representation in the Congress, a laudable goal. But one of the ancillary effects of that is that you're removing minorities from all the other districts in order to create these minority districts. So you have, in the vast majority of districts, Republican districts, very few, for example, Latino voters, often very few black voters. So the question is about the trade-off. What have we given up in order to create these minority districts? And what's the right balance?
I don't know what the right balance is, but if there is nothing to lose for a candidate because there aren't enough constituents in a district, then something's really wrong. And if you add to that the efforts that are made sometimes for these minorities not to vote, then there is really a big problem. So I don't know what the right balance is, but I do know that to have a small percentage of minorities in any district that really don't represent reality, it's not right.
Jim, you've got the
microphone.
So, do we have questions here? Got a whole bunch of hands up here.
I know.
Deans can run. Come on.
Hi. My question is for Mr. Wolfson. On the bipartisan system, one thing that people argue is that it's much more stable than not having that two-party system. How would you respond to that?
Well, I do think you see in other countries that have a more vigorous multi-party system some greater churn. So in countries in Europe where you have third and fourth and fifth parties that are more active and are given an opportunity to gain power through the nature of the system, you do have situations where an extreme party, for instance, like you see, let's say in a country like Greece, can get 18-20% of the vote and actually have a meaningful representation in the assembly, in the parliament, or you see in France where the party of Le Pen is in a position to gain more prominence because of the way the system works. So, yes, there is some truth to that. I think, you know, we are so far away from that in this country that providing a little bit more opportunity for some greater diversity of candidates and views in parties would be a good thing. So I think it is a fair question, and it's a concern in some parts of the world. But it seems to me that in this country our problem is the opposite, that we have two parties that frequently put up people on both extremes, and there's just not enough coming together in the middle.
I'm gonna get that. Yeah. Get to a student real fast. Okay.
This is how the dean gets exercise.
Hi. Oh. My question is just for everyone here. Do you think that the Electoral College helps our democracy, or does it do a disservice to our citizens by not allowing popular vote for the presidency?
When I was in Congress, I introduced a constitutional amendment to elect the president by popular vote. The problem is it passed in the House of Representatives. It will never pass in the Senate because the small state senators will never vote for it.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on.
We would like to associate our remarks with what the congressman just said.
All right, so this is a bit of a two-part question. I think that's sort of allowed. Do you agree that large companies and special interest groups exert a great degree of control over our Congress, our elections, and the entire political system? And if you agree with that statement, what should be done to change that? That's for anybody out there.
Well, we should have a two-part answer. We should let Neera and Murphy each have a chance to answer this question.
I'll answer the first, yes.
I'll answer half the first. Interest groups, yes. Large corporations, overrated as far as their influence, but that's a very popular narrative. Actually, corporate political expenditure has not been nearly as large as people suspected. It's been wealthy individuals on both sides that really fueled it. And what do you do about it? Voters should vote to punish it if they don't like it. I'm not for arbitrary limits on speech.
Anybody else want to engage on this? Should we move
okay.
on?
Yeah. Yep.
This question is also for anyone on the panel. Do you think any of President Obama's recent policies and decisions, either domestic or foreign, are to the advantage of either party going into the midterms? And if so, do you think it will be enough to make a difference on the final outcome of the elections?
Why don't you answer that, Axelrod?
I'm just moderating.
It's good to have Senator Orman here from Kansas. I'll just say this, his favorable rating is down to 41 and Broccoli's at 44. That's not a good position to be in a midterm election.
I mean, obviously, look, I think if you're a Democrat or a Democratic strategist, your theory on this is and you saw Mike's answer on what would a Republican presidential candidate be talking about, which is middle-class economics. Instead, we're talking about terrorism and foreign policy, and those are traditionally issues that have not favored Democrats. And I think, you know, for a lot of reasons why I answered the Senate would go Republican, one of them is I think the issue terrain has moved away from what Democrats ought to be or want to be discussing, and on to a series of foreign policy and terrorism issues that, while they're certainly suited to discuss, it's not something that is going to excite a lot of people going into this race.
Follow-on question for the panel. At the beginning of the year, the Republican mantra was that the Affordable Care Act was going to be the decisive issue in the election. Does anybody here feel that it will be? And if not, why not?
That's a good question. It's big, but I don't think it's the only issue. And to some extent, it's built into the thing now. It's kind of played out. If you're a base Democratic voter, you're pretty okay on the ACA. If you're a base Republican voter, you don't like it. The question is persuadable voters. It is more of a political problem, I think, in most places than a positive, at least the data I show. But I think now the election's about a couple of things and it's one. But I don't think I think the media might have gotten one beat bigger than reality on that. But you can't say it's a small issue because it is a big issue and it is unpopular if the voters account.
Larry, you're out there. Are you seeing it?
I think this, that the Republicans in the beginning of this cycle had hoped it would be because of its unpopularity, as Mike points out. It could have been, but they so damaged their image in the extreme way that they used the ACA to obstruct things in Congress, the extreme rhetoric, that it basically helped create this image that the thing that people don't like about Republicans. So they kind of neutered themselves in their ability to use it, but because by raising it, they sort of raised their own, the specter of their own negatives, so they've moved on to other issues.
I mean, the ACA is just not, there's just not that much ad money on ACA right now. I mean, there definitely was earlier in the cycle, but there's, it could be completely baked in, so it doesn't make any sense to advertise it. But if you just look at the numbers of dollars on the ACA or that mention the ACA, it's plummeted.
But Nira, let me ask you this, because you're very conversant in the ACA, and you obviously are fluent in the benefits of the ACA. Why is it that opposition is more motivated than supporters? Why aren't more Democrats positively motivated by the ACA to want to vote?
I mean, the ACA still is touching, like, out of the population, relatively few people. Most people have insurance. I think the ACA has become, for the conservative base, an effective way to rail against the size of government and things like that. You do see with pockets of groups that are very important for Democrats, single women, Latinos, they self-identify the ACA, they mention the ACA itself as a positive. Whether this will change as more and more people know people who've been affected, I don't know. I would definitely agree that it is.